This is an auto-narrated audiobook, generated by Google. Book In Search of the Unknown by Robert W. Chambers. Lesson 1. Because it all seems so improbable, so horribly impossible to me now, sitting here safe and sane in my own library, I hesitate to record an episode which already appears to me less horrible than grotesque. Yet, unless this story is written now, I know I shall never have the courage to tell the truth about the matter, not from fear of ridicule, but because I myself shall soon cease to credit what I now know to be true. Yet scarcely a month has elapsed since I heard the stealthy purring of what I believe to be the shoaling undertow. Scarcely a month ago, with my own eyes, I saw that which even now I am beginning to believe never existed. As for the harbor master, and the blow I am now striking at the old order of things, but of that I shall not speak now or later. I shall try to tell the story simply and truthfully, and let my friends testify as to my probity and the publishers of this book corroborate them. On the 29th of February, I resigned my position under the government, and left Washington to accept an offer from Professor Farrago, whose name he kindly permits me to use, and on the first day of April, I entered upon my new and congenial duties as General Superintendent of the Waterfowl Department, connected with the Zoological Gardens, then in course of erection at Bronx Park, New York. For a week I followed the routine, examining the new foundations, studying the architect's plans, following the surveyors through the Bronx thickets, suggesting arrangements for watercourses and pools destined to be included in the enclosures for swans, geese, pelicans, herons, and such of the waders and swimmers as we might expect to acclimate in Bronx Park. It was at that time the policy of the trustees and officers of the Zoological Gardens neither to employ collectors nor to send out expeditions in search of specimens. The society decided to depend upon voluntary contributions, and I was always busy, part of the day, in dictating answers to correspondents who wrote offering their services as hunters of big game, collectors of all sorts of fauna, trappers, snarers, and also to those who offered specimens for sale, usually at exorbitant rates. To the proprietors of five-legged kittens, mangy lynxes, moth-eaten coyotes, and dancing bears, I returned courteous but uncompromising refusals, of course, first submitting all such letters together with my replies to Professor Farrago. One day towards the end of May, however, just as I was leaving Bronx Park to return to town, Professor Lessard, of the Reptilian Department, called out to me that Professor Farrago wanted to see me a moment. So I put my pipe into my pocket again and retraced my steps to the temporary wooden building occupied by Professor Farrago, General Superintendent of the Zoological Gardens. The professor, who was sitting at his desk before a pile of letters and replies submitted for approval by me, pushed his glasses down and looked over them at me with a whimsical smile that suggested amusement, impatience, annoyance, and perhaps a faint trace of apology. "Now, here's a letter," he said, with a deliberate gesture towards a sheet of paper impaled on a file, "a letter that I suppose you remember." He disengaged the sheet of paper and handed it to me. "Oh, yes," I replied with a shrug. "Of course the man is mistaken, or..." "Or what?" demanded Professor Farrago, tranquilly, wiping his glasses. "Or a liar," I replied. After a silence, he leaned back in his chair and bade me read the letter to him again, and I did so with a contemptuous tolerance for the writer, who must have been either a very innocent victim or a very stupid swindler. I said as much to Professor Farrago, but to my surprise, he appeared to waver. "I suppose," he said, with his near-sighted, embarrassed smile, "that 999 men in 1,000 would throw that letter aside and condemn the writer as a liar or a fool." "In my opinion," said I, "he's one or the other." "He isn't in mine," said the professor placidly. "What?" I exclaimed. "Here is a man living all alone on a strip of rock and sand, between the wilderness and the sea, who wants you to send somebody to take charge of a bird that doesn't exist." "How do you know," asked Professor Farrago, that the bird in question does not exist. It is generally accepted, I replied sarcastically, that the great auk has been extinct for years. Therefore, I may be pardoned for doubting that our correspondent possesses a pair of them alive. Oh, you young fellows, said the professor, smiling wearily, you embark on a theory for destinations that don't exist. He leaned back in his chair, his amused eyes searching space for the imagery that made him smile. Like swimming squirrels, you navigate with the help of heaven and a stiff breeze, but you never land where you hope to, do you? Rather red in the face, I said, don't you believe the great auk to be extinct? Audubon saw the great auk. Who has seen a single specimen since? Nobody, except our correspondent here, he replied, laughing. I laughed too, considering the interview at an end, but the professor went on coolly. Whatever it is that our correspondent has, and I am daring to believe that it is the great auk itself, I want you to secure it for the society. When my astonishment subsided, my first conscious sentiment was one of pity. Clearly, Professor Farrago was on the verge of dotage. Ah, what a loss to the world! I believe now that Professor Farrago perfectly interpreted my thoughts, but he betrayed neither resentment nor impatience. I drew a chair up beside his desk. There was nothing to do but to obey, and this fool's errand was none of my conceiving. Together we made out a list of articles necessary for me, and itemized the expenses I might incur, and I set a date for my return, allowing no margin for a successful termination to the expedition. Never mind that, said the professor. What I want you to do is to get those birds here safely. Now, how many men will you take? None, I replied bluntly. It's a useless expense unless there is something to bring back. If there is, I'll wire you, you may be sure. Very well, said Professor Farrago good-humoredly, you shall have all the assistance you may require. Can you leave tonight? The old gentleman was certainly prompt. I nodded, half sulkily, aware of his amusement. So, I said, picking up my hat, I am to start north to find a place called Black Harbor, where there is a man named Halyard who possesses, among other household utensils, two extinct great auks. We were both laughing by this time. I asked him why on earth he credited the assertion of a man he had never before heard of. I suppose, he replied, with the same half-apologetic, half-humorous smile, it is instinct. I feel somehow that this man Halyard has got an auk, perhaps two. I can't get away from the idea that we are on the eve of acquiring the rarest of living creatures. It's odd for a scientist to talk as I do. Doubtless you're shocked, admit it now. But I was not shocked. On the contrary, I was conscious that the same strange hope that Professor Farrago cherished was beginning, in spite of me, to stir my pulses too. If he has, I began, then stopped. The professor and I looked hard at each other in silence. Go on, he said encouragingly. But I had nothing more to say, for the prospect of beholding with my own eyes a living specimen of the great auk produced a series of conflicting emotions within me, which rendered speech profanely superfluous. As I took my leave, Professor Farrago came to the door of the temporary wooden office and handed me the letter written by the man Halyard. I folded it and put it into my pocket, as Halyard might require it for my own identification. How much does he want for the pair? I asked. $10,000. Don't demur, if the birds are really. I know, I said hastily, not daring to hope too much. One thing more, said Professor Farrago gravely. You know, in that last paragraph of his letter, Halyard speaks of something else in the way of specimens, an undiscovered species of amphibious biped. Just read that paragraph again, will you? I drew the letter from my pocket and read as he directed. When you have seen the two living specimens of the great auk, and have satisfied yourself that I tell the truth, you may be wise enough to listen without prejudice to a statement I shall make concerning the existence of the strangest creature ever fashioned. I will merely say at this time that the creature referred to is an amphibious biped and inhabits the ocean near this coast. More I cannot say, for I personally have not seen the animal, but I have a witness who has, and there are many who affirm that they have seen the creature. You will naturally say that my statement amounts to nothing, but when your representative arrives, if he be free from prejudice, I expect his reports to you concerning the sea biped will confirm the solemn statements of a witness I know to be unimpeachable. Yours truly, Burton Halyard. Black Harbor. Well, I said, after a moment's thought, here goes for the wild goose chase. Wild ock, you mean, said Professor Farrago, shaking hands with me. You will start tonight, won't you? Yes, but heaven knows how I'm ever going to land in this man Halyard's dooryard. Goodbye. About that sea biped, began Professor Farrago shyly. Oh, don't. I said, I can swallow the ox, feathers and claws, but if this fellow Halyard is hinting he's seen an amphibious creature resembling a man. Or a woman, said the professor cautiously. I retired, disgusted, my faith shaken in the mental vigor of Professor Farrago. End of the lesson. Lesson 2. The 3 days' voyage by boat and rail was irksome. I bought my kit at St. Croix on the Central Pacific Railroad, and on June 1st, I began the last stage of my journey via the St. Isol broad gauge, arriving in the wilderness by daylight. A tedious forced march by blaze trail, freshly spotted on the wrong side, of course, brought me to the northern terminus of the rusty narrow-gauge lumber railway which runs from the heart of the hushed pine wilderness to the sea. Already a long train of battered flat cars, piled with sluice props and roughly hewn sleepers, was moving slowly off into the brooding forest gloom when I came in sight of the track, but I developed a gratifying and unexpected burst of speed, shouting all the while. The train stopped. I swung myself aboard the last car, where a pleasant young fellow was sitting on the rear brake, chewing spruce and reading a letter. "Come aboard, sir," he said, looking up with a smile. "I guess you're the man in a hurry." "I'm looking for a man named Halyard," I said, dropping rifle and knapsack on the fresh-cut, fragrant pile of pine. "Are you Halyard?" "No, I'm Francis Lee, bossing the Mica Pit at Port of Waves," he replied. "But this letter is from Halyard, asking me to look out for a man in a hurry from Bronx Park, New York." "I'm that man," said I, filling my pipe and offering him a share of the weed of peace, and we sat side by side smoking very amiably, until a signal from the locomotive sent him forward and I was left alone, lounging at ease, head pillowed on both arms, watching the blue sky flying through the branches overhead. Long before we came in sight of the ocean, I smelled it. The fresh salt aroma stole into my senses, drowsy with the heated odor of pine and hemlock, and I sat up, peering ahead into the dusky sea of pines. Fresher and fresher came the wind from the sea, in puffs, in mild sweet breezes, in steady freshening currents, blowing the feathery crowns of the pines, setting the balsam's blue tufts rocking. Lee wandered back over the long line of flats, balancing himself nonchalantly as the cars swung around a sharp curve, where water dripped from a newly propped sluice that suddenly emerged from the depths of the forest to run parallel to the railroad track. "Built it this spring," he said, surveying his handiwork which seemed to undulate as the car swept past. "It runs to the cove, or ought to," he stopped abruptly with a thoughtful glance at me. "So you're going over to Halyard's," he continued, as though answering a question asked by himself. I nodded. "You've never been there, of course?" "No," I said, "and I'm not likely to go again." I would have told him why I was going, if I had not already begun to feel ashamed of my idiotic errand. "I guess you're going to look at those birds of his," continued Lee, placidly. "I guess I am," I said sulkily, glancing askance to see whether he was smiling. But he only asked me, quite seriously, whether a great auk was really a very rare bird, and I told him that the last one ever seen had been found dead off Labrador in January 1870. Then I asked him whether these birds of Halyard's were really great auks, and he replied, somewhat indifferently, that he supposed they were. At least nobody had ever before seen such birds near Port of Waves. "There's something else," he said, running a pine sliver through his pipe stem, "something that interests us all here more than ox, big or little. I suppose I might as well speak of it, as you are bound to hear about it sooner or later." He hesitated, and I could see that he was embarrassed, searching for the exact words to convey his meaning. "If," said I, "you have anything in this region more important to science than the great auk, I should be very glad to know about it." Perhaps there was the faintest tinge of sarcasm in my voice, for he shot a sharp glance at me and then turned slightly. After a moment, however, he put his pipe into his pocket, laid hold of the brake with both hands, vaulted to his perch aloft, and glanced down at me. "Did you ever hear of the harbor master?" he asked maliciously.
"Which harbor master?"
I inquired.
"You'll know before long," he observed with a satisfied glance into perspective.
This rather extraordinary observation puzzled me. I waited for him to resume, and as he did not, I asked him what he meant.
"If I knew," he said, "I'd tell you. But come to think of it, I'd be a fool to go into details with a scientific man. You'll hear about the harbor master, perhaps you will see the harbor master. In that event, I should be glad to converse with you on the subject." I could not help laughing at his prim and precise manner, and after a moment he also laughed, saying, "It hurts a man's vanity to know he knows a thing that somebody else knows he doesn't know. I'm damned if I say another word about the harbor master until you've been to Halyards."
"A harbor master," I persisted, "is an official who superintends the mooring of ships, isn't he?" But he refused to be tempted into conversation, and we lounged silently on the lumber until a long, thin whistle from the locomotive and a rush of stinging salt wind brought us to our feet. Through the trees, I could see the bluish-black ocean stretching out beyond black headlands to meet the clouds. A great wind was roaring among the trees as the train slowly came to a stand still on the edge of the primeval forest. Lee jumped to the ground and aided me with my rifle and pack, and then the train began to back away along a curved sidetrack which Lee said led to the mica pit and company stores.
"Now what will you do?"
he asked pleasantly. "I can give you a good dinner and a decent bed tonight if you like, and I'm sure Mrs. Lee would be very glad to have you stop with us as long as you choose." I thanked him, but said that I was anxious to reach Halyards before dark, and he very kindly led me along the cliffs and pointed out the path.
"This man Halyard," he said, "is an invalid. He lives at a cove called Black Harbor, and all his truck goes through to him over the company's road. We receive it here, and send a pack mule through once a month. I've met him. He's a bad-tempered hypochondriac, a cynic at heart, and a man whose word is never doubted. If he says he has a great auk, you may be satisfied he has." My heart was beating with excitement at the prospect. I looked out across the wooded headlands and tangled stretches of dune and hollow, trying to realize what it might mean to me, to Professor Farrago, to the world, if I should lead back to New York a live auk.
"He's a crank," said Lee. "Frankly, I don't like him. If you find it unpleasant there, come back to us."
"Does Halyard live alone?" I asked.
"Yes, except for a professional trained nurse, poor thing."
"A man?"
"No," said Lee disgustedly. Presently he gave me a peculiar glance, hesitated, and finally said, "Ask Halyard to tell you about his nurse and the harbor master. Goodbye, I'm due at the quarry. Come and stay with us whenever you care to. You will find a welcome at Port of Waves." We shook hands and parted on the cliff, he turning back into the forest along the railway, I starting northward, pack slung, rifle over my shoulder. Once I met a group of quarrymen, faces burned brick red, scarred hands swinging as they walked. And as I passed them with a nod, turning, I saw that they also had turned to look after me, and I caught a word or two of their conversation whirled back to me on the sea wind. They were speaking of the harbor master. End of the lesson. Lesson 3. Toward sunset, I came out on a sheer granite cliff where the seabirds were whirling and clamoring, and the great breakers dashed,
rolling in double thundered reverberations on the sun-dyed crimson sands below the rock. Across the half-moon of beach towered another cliff, and behind this, I saw a column of smoke rising in the still air. It certainly came from Halyard's chimney, although the opposite cliff prevented me from seeing the house itself. I rested a moment to refill my pipe, then resumed rifle and pack, and cautiously started to skirt the cliffs. I had descended halfway towards the beach, and was examining the cliff opposite, when something on the very top of the rock arrested my attention, a man darkly outlined against the sky. The next moment, however, I knew it could not be a man, for the object suddenly glided over the face of the cliff and slid down the sheer smooth lace like a lizard. Before I could get a square look at it, the thing crawled into the surf, or at least it seemed to, but the whole episode occurred so suddenly, so unexpectedly, that I was not sure I had seen anything at all. However, I was curious enough to climb the cliff on the land side and make my way towards the spot where I imagined I saw the man. Of course, there was nothing there, not a trace of a human being, I mean. Something had been there, a sea otter possibly, for the remains of a freshly killed fish lay on the rock, eaten to the backbone and tail. The next moment, below me, I saw the house, a freshly painted trim, flimsy structure, modern, and very much out of harmony with the splendid savagery surrounding it. It struck a nasty, cheap note in the noble gray monotony of headland and sea. The descent was easy enough. I crossed the crescent beach, hard as pink marble, and found a little trodden path among the rocks that led to the front porch of the house. There were two people on the porch. I heard their voices before I saw them, and when I set my foot upon the wooden steps, I saw one of them, a woman, rise from her chair and step hastily towards me. "Come back," cried the other, a man with a smooth-shaven, deeply lined face and a pair of angry blue eyes, and the woman stepped back quietly, acknowledging my lifted hat with a silent inclination. The man, who was reclining in an invalid's rolling chair, clapped both large, pale hands to the wheels and pushed himself out along the porch. He had shawls pinned about him, an untidy drab-colored hat on his head, and when he looked down at me, he scowled. "I know who you are," he said in his acid voice. "You're one of the zoological men from Bronx Park. You look like it, anyway." "It is easy to recognize you from your reputation," I replied, irritated at his discourtesy. "Really," he replied, with something between a sneer and a laugh, "I'm obliged for your frankness. You're after my great ox, are you not?" "Nothing else would have tempted me into this place," I replied, sincerely. "Thank heaven for that," he said. "Sit down a moment, you've interrupted us." Then, turning to the young woman, who wore the neat gown and tiny cap of a professional nurse, he bade her resume what she had been saying. She did so with a deprecating glance at me, which made the old man sneer again. "It happened so suddenly," she said in her low voice, "that I had no chance to get back. The boat was drifting in the cove. I sat in the stern reading, both oars shipped and the tiller swinging. Then I heard a scratching under the boat, but thought it might be seaweed, and next moment came those soft thumpings, like the sound of a big fish rubbing its nose against a float." Halyard clutched the wheels of his chair and stared at the girl in grim displeasure. "Didn't you know enough to be frightened?" he demanded. "No, not then," she said, coloring faintly, "but when, after a few moments, I looked up and saw the harbormaster running up and down the beach, I was horribly frightened." "Really," said Halyard sarcastically, "it was about time." Then, turning to me, he rasped out, "And that young lady was obliged to row all the way to Port of Waves and call to Lee's quarryman to take her boat in." Completely mystified, I looked from Halyard to the girl, not in the least comprehending what all this meant. "That will do," said Halyard ungraciously, which curt phrase was apparently the usual dismissal for the nurse. She rose, and I rose, and she passed me with an inclination, stepping noiselessly into the house. "I want beef tea," bawled Halyard after her, then he gave me an unamiable glance. "I was a well-bred man," he sneered. "I'm a Harvard graduate too, but I live as I like, and I do what I like, and I say what I like. You certainly are not reticent, I said, disgusted. Why should I be, he rasped. I pay that young woman for my irritability, it's a bargain between us. In your domestic affairs, I said, there is nothing that interests me. I came to see those ox. You probably believe them to be razor-billed ox, he said contemptuously. But they're not, they're great ox. I suggested that he permit me to examine them, and he replied, indifferently, that they were in a pen in his backyard, and that I was free to step around the house when I cared to. I laid my rifle and pack on the veranda, and hastened off with mixed emotions, among which hope no longer predominated. No man in his senses would keep two such precious prizes in a pen in his backyard, I argued, and I was perfectly prepared to find anything from a puffin to a penguin in that pen. I shall never forget, as long as I live, my stupor of amazement when I came to the wire-covered enclosure. Not only were there two great ox in the pen, alive, breathing, squatting in bulky majesty on their seaweed bed, but one of them was gravely contemplating two newly hatched chicks, all bill and feet, which nestled sedately at the edge of a puddle of salt water where some small fish were swimming. For a while excitement blinded, nay, deafened me. I tried to realize that I was gazing upon the last individuals of an all but extinct race, the sole survivors of the gigantic auk, which for 30 years has been accounted an extinct creature. I believe that I did not move muscle nor limb, until the sun had gone down and the crowding darkness blurred my straining eyes and blotted the great, silent, bright-eyed birds from sight. Even then I could not tear myself away from the enclosure. I listened to the strange, drowsy note of the male bird, the fainter responses of the female, the thin plaints of the chicks, huddling under her breast. I heard their flipper-like, embryonic wings beating sleepily as the birds stretched and yawned their beaks and clacked them, preparing for slumber. If you please, came a soft voice from the door, Mr. Halyard awaits your company to dinner. End of the lesson. Lesson 4. I dined well, or rather I might have enjoyed my dinner if Mr. Halyard had been eliminated, and the feast consisted exclusively of a joint of beef, the pretty nurse, and myself. She was exceedingly attractive, with a disturbing fashion of lowering her head and raising her dark eyes when spoken to. As for Halyard, he was unspeakable, bundled up in his snuffy shawls and making uncouth noises over his gruel. But it is only just to say that his table was worth sitting down to, and his wine was sound as a bell. "Yeah," he snapped, "I'm sick of this cursed soup and I'll trouble you to fill my glass." "It is dangerous for you to touch claret," said the pretty nurse. "I might as well die at dinner as anywhere," he observed. "Certainly," said I, cheerfully passing the decanter, but he did not appear overpleased with the attention. "I can't smoke either," he snarled, hitching the shawls around until he looked like Richard III. However, he was good enough to shove a box of cigars at me, and I took one and stood up, as the pretty nurse slipped past and vanished into the little parlor beyond. We sat there for a while without speaking. He picked irritably at the breadcrumbs on the cloth, never glancing in my direction, and I, tired from my long foot tour, lay back in my chair, silently appreciating one of the best cigars I ever smoked. "Well," he rasped out at length, "what do you think of my ox and my veracity?" I told him that both were unimpeachable. "Didn't they call me a swindler down there at your museum?" he demanded. I admitted that I had heard the term applied. Then I made a clean breast of the matter, telling him that it was I who had doubted, that my chief, Professor Farrago, had sent me against my will, and that I was ready and glad to admit that he, Mr. Halyard, was a benefactor of the human race. "Bosh," he said. "What good does a confounded, wobbly, bandy-toed bird do to the human race?" But he was pleased, nevertheless, and presently he asked me, not unamiably, to punish his claret again. "I'm done for," he said. "Good things to eat and drink are no good to me. Some day I'll get mad enough to have a fit, and then—" He paused to yawn. "Then," he continued, "that little nurse of mine will drink up my claret and go back to civilization, where people are polite. Somehow or other, in spite of the fact that Halyard was an old pig, what he said touched me. There was certainly not much left in life for him, as he regarded life. "I'm going to leave her this house," he said, arranging his shawls. "She doesn't know it."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.